Congratulations, you've made it to level 90 in Star Wars Galaxies. So now what? This video will give new and returning players guidance in continuing their story in a galaxy far, far away by briefly covering the following topics. Making quick credits to get started. Getting gear appropriate for your level, quests and rewards you may want to consider prioritizing. Profession-specific content, and prerequisite quests you'll need to complete in order to participate in Heroics, or otherwise known as Dungeons. Note that the content of this video is specific to the SWG Legends emulator. Parts of this video may be applicable to other emulators, but changes specific to the Legends emulator will result in some differences, like the availability and tradability of some items. Before going anywhere, in the chat box, enter the command /flash to receive a free 2-passenger speeder. If your flash speeder is destroyed, you can re-enter the command to receive a new one at the cost of some credits. This command is great because the speeder is free and allows you to skip the A Speeder For Me starter quest. Next, if it isn't already open, enter the command /claim to open the reward claim window. Select the X-Wing or TIE Fighter instant travel vehicle option. This will grant your character the ability to summon an instant travel vehicle, or ITV for short, that can take them to any starport, shuttleport, or camp with a shuttle beacon that's available on the planet they're currently on. ITVs can only be placed outside of non-player cities and other no-build zones. The best part of ITVs is that they're free, letting you save credits by skipping on purchasing travel tickets. You'll also want a starship before heading out on your adventure. The fastest option is to open the reward claim menu and select the 180-day Jump to Lightspeed Veteran Reward, the Sorosub Luxury Yacht. This reward will place an item in your inventory that can generate a Sorosub Luxury Yacht in your datapad. At Starship Terminals, you'll be able to travel to other planets for free or launch the ship to fly around in space freely. Note that the yacht's components can't be modified and the ship doesn't come equipped with weapons, so you'll be unable to complete most space missions with this ship. Luckily, you won't be targeted by other ships while flying the yacht in open space. Instead of relying on the yacht, my recommendation would be to get a starfighter from a pilot trainer, as some of the quests suggested in this video will require a combination of ground and space missions. While other players can help you complete these missions, bypassing the need to level up your piloting skills, flying the yacht is very slow. The most convenient pilot trainer is Dravis, a representative from the Smugglers Alliance located in the back of the Mos Eisley Cantina. After speaking with him, he'll give you a ship for free and a quest to complete. Using your datapad, you can abandon this mission and keep the ship. You can always speak to Dravis again in the future to restart the mission. If you later decide you want to start training with a different pilot trainer, you can speak with Gil Burton in the Bastine Hotel to retire as a freelance pilot. Lastly, head over to the Mos Eisley Cloning Center and pay to store your DNA in the cloning terminal. You'll never know when you want to take the Cloner Express to quickly get back to the entertainers, medics, and officers Eisley offers. You'll find yourself broke at least once in your Star Wars adventure, at the beginning. While you could head out to Frosh Bunker on Corellia and slowly siphon credits from the Away From Keyboard groups, there are some more productive activities you can complete at the keyboard. Mission terminals placed throughout the galaxy give you access to simple, repeatable missions that reward you with enough credits to take the shuttle a few times or buy a weapon better than what your profession wheel provides you with at level 50. I recommend prioritizing missions that have you targeting humanoid non-player character bases, like Thug Outposts, as they'll drop credits in addition to other loot. Smugglers should remember that they can radio the terminal and select the Slice option to increase the payout of the next mission they accept. Note that the payout bonus will be lost if you refresh the first list of missions you get after slicing the terminal. Smugglers can slice terminals every 2 minutes. 10 terminal missions can be completed a day for rewards. If you haven't already completed it, I recommend speaking to Rilo Baruch at Jabba's Palace to start the Jabba's Theme Park Quest series. This is an easy way to earn pocket money while gaining access to other parts of Jabba's Palace, like the throne room. Having access to the throne room is important because this is where you'll find the infamous bounty hunter, Boba Fett. Asking the armor-clad bounty hunter about a group named Death Watch will result in Boba giving you access codes to their base of operations on Endor. Having access to the Death Watch bunker is important as other quests in the game, like the Imperial Theme Park, will require you to enter the bunker. You also never know when you'll want to try your hand at acquiring a jetpack or Mandalorian armor yourself. My last suggestion would be to sell one-time account rewards to other players. This can put a few million credits in your pockets quickly, but keep in mind that these are items you'll only get once, and purchasing them back later could be more expensive. Here are a few examples of one-time account items you can sell and how many credits you could expect to earn. The following equipment recommendations reflect a good starting point for a level 90 combat profession. Ideal, or best-in-slot gear recommendations won't be part of this video as those are longer-term goals for players. Our goal in this video is to get you into the game. Soloing raid mechanics will come later. Jedis are different, so let's start with getting them some robes. Head to a starship terminal and travel to the pirate outpost on Dantooine. A few thousand meters west of the outpost, you'll find a Jedi statue. In front of the shrine, enter the command /kneel in the chat box. Once you're in a respectful pose, radio the statue and select the robe replacement option to receive a level 80 Jedi robe with dark coloring. If chocolate isn't your flavor, there is another statue outside the Imperial outpost on Yavin 4 that serves vanilla. Note that the planet determines the level requirement and color of the robe you receive, so it is important to get robes from either the shrines on Dantooine or Yavin 4. If you go to the shrine outside of Mos Eisley, you'll get robes appropriate for level 21 characters, which offer far less protection. Lightsabers are special weapons in that they can't be traded or sold. This means you'll need to craft your own lightsaber. While you can purchase the necessary tools and resources individually from other players, I recommend buying a 4th generation lightsaber crafting kit. In short, these are containers other players have filled with everything you'll need to assemble a 4th generation lightsaber, which saves you time and potentially credits. Here's how to find these kits. Head to any bazaar terminal and left-click it to open the auction list. At the top of the main window, select the Vendor Location tab. Under Location Filter, select Entire Galaxy. Below this, in the Object Type Filter list, expand the Miscellaneous tab and select the Wearable Container category. Finally, in the Item Name filter, enter the phrases 4th and Lightsaber, then click Refresh. Your auction list should now display 4th generation lightsaber crafting kits available on player vendors throughout the galaxy. Once you find one you like, make sure it is highlighted in the auction list and click the Create Waypoint option in the middle of the auction list window. A waypoint will be added to your datapad, which will guide you to the player's vendor so you can purchase the item. If the kit doesn't include a lightsaber crafting toolkit, the tool you'll need to make the lightsaber, you'll want to find and purchase one of those too. Any toolkit with a tool effectiveness rating of 15 is perfect. A 4th generation lightsaber needs one color crystal to activate and can hold up to 4 additional power crystals or create dragon pearls to boost its damage. Common color crystals are inexpensive, so I recommend picking up your favorite color or whatever is appropriate for your roleplay. You'll also want to consider grabbing 4 power crystals or create pearls of select or quality rating, as they're also cheap and offer a good damage boost. Now that you have everything you need, let's craft the lightsaber. Head to any weapon, droid, and general item crafting station, like the one near the Mos Eisley Medical Center in Starport, and double-click your lightsaber toolkit to begin the crafting process. Don't worry if your lightsaber isn't perfect, as you'll get more equipment in the future to aid in the crafting process. You'll also want to replace your 4th generation lightsaber with a 5th generation once you unlock 5th generation schematics. For the non-Jedi combat professions, you'll want to start by purchasing a weapon appropriate for your level. Crafted weapons are superior to their looted counterparts, so my recommendation is to purchase one from a trader. Go to any bazaar terminal and left-click it to open the auction list. At the top of the auction list window, click the Vendor Location tab. Under Location Filter, select Entire Galaxy. In the Object Type Filter list, expand the Weapon category. Select the category of weapon you're looking for, like pistol. Below the Object Type Filter, check the box Enable Item Attribute Filter. Using the attribute drop-down box on the right, select Combat Level Required. In the Minimum and Maximum Value fields, enter the number 90. Below the value fields, check the box Item Must Have Attribute, then click Add. Finally, click the Refresh button at the bottom of the auction list window. Your search results will now only show you pistols with the combat level requirement of 90 being sold across the entire galaxy on player vendors. However, these results will show both looted and crafted weapons. You can narrow down these results to crafted weapons by adding the Sockets Available attribute to the search with the value set to 1, as looted weapons will never have an open socket. Keep in mind, this will filter out weapons that have their socket occupied by a weapon attachment already, but those weapons aren't starter gear, so it's okay to exclude them in this situation. The attribute filter is a great tool that I recommend playing around with when you have the time. I really enjoy being able to search weapons by elemental type so I can exclude a type I'm not looking for, or find a specific type to round out my arsenal. In case you're not finding a crafted weapon in your price range, an alternative would be to purchase a Mustafarian loot weapon. Their damage won't be as high as crafted weapons, but players typically sell them for cheaper. Take note, though, that some can only be wielded by certain professions, like OR5's DE10. Once you find a weapon you like, click click the Create Waypoint button in the middle of the auction list window while the item is highlighted. A waypoint will be placed in your datapad that will guide you to the player vendor you'll need to travel to in order to purchase the item. If you're looking to save every credit possible, you can generate a weapon using the Chugandar Cube. For example, players can generate a lava cannon using the combination of a faintly glowing module interface, a dimly glowing liquid, and a dimly glowing pair of binoculars. We'll cover where to get the Chugandar Cube in the Mustafar section of this video. The armor granted to players via the profession wheel affords little protection, so you'll want to replace that armor as soon as possible. Like weapons, the stats of crafted armor are better than armor sets you'll loot or receive as quest rewards, so buying a cheap set now with the intention of replacing it later is a great idea. Go to the Bazaar terminal and click the Vendor Location tab in the Auction List window. Filter to the entire galaxy again, and in the Object Item Filter, expand the Miscellaneous category. Select the Wearable Container category and enter the word Armor in the Item Name field. Click Refresh and you'll be given a list of bags that players have filled with a variety of armor sets. You'll be able to find complete sets with the maximum protection possible for less than 500,000 credits. Keep in mind that Wookiees and Ithorians can't wear all the same armor pieces other humanoid species can. If you're a Wookiee, pick an armor set with Kashyykan in the name, and if you're an Ithorian, pick one with Ithorian in the title. Don't worry about purchasing armors with layers or skill modifiers. There's something you'll want to upgrade to later when you have the available credits. If you can't find an affordable set of armor, head to the Dierra Cantina on Talus and speak with Mort. This will start a series of quests which will ultimately reward you with the Katarn armor, a set of battle armor with a moderate level of protection. Personal shield generators occupy the waste slot on your character and offer additional protection against incoming ranged attacks. You may want to consider purchasing a cheap one if you're looking to get a little bit more protection. Non-Jedi professions will want to upgrade to a great one once they have the funds available. Jedis may or may not ultimately use personal shield generators depending on their final equipment setup, as some players choose to wear the belt of Bodo Boss in their waste slot instead. Lastly, I recommend everyone pick up a crate of Akoragum. Some of these quests will have you traveling across entire planets, so the speed boost the drink provides is a welcome time-saving addition. The Secrets of the Siren quest series was changed on SWG Legends to reward the player with the ability Call for G9 Rigger Pickup. The G9 Rigger is an instant travel vehicle that allows players to store up to 3 locations in the galaxy and instantly travel to them for no cost. These locations can be overwritten by the player at any time. Anywhere an ITV can be called is a location that can be stored. This is handy for getting back to your house or important quest points quickly, so it is highly recommended to grab this item earlier rather than later. You'll start this quest by visiting one of 3 non-player characters. The NPC you visit will depend on your character's current faction affiliation. Rebels will find Viga Medish in the Tyrena Cantina on Corellia. An Alliance player should visit Tyla Jin in the Theed Cantina on Naboo. And Imperials will report to Jivan Monsul inside the Bastine Cantina on Tatooine. Unaligned players will eventually have to join the Rebel Alliance or Empire to complete the quest series. After completing the quest and receiving your reward, you can speak with a recruiter to leave the faction you joined if you wish to remain unaligned. Note that you'll need some piloting experience and a decent ship, or the help of another skilled pilot, to complete this quest series. I've linked to a walkthrough of this questline in the description of this video. Mustafar is an excellent place for new level 90 combat characters to visit. Most of its content can be completed alone or in small groups, and many of its rewards are used for player versus player and endgame player versus environment content. Before purchasing a travel ticket to Pizza Planet, you'll want to make sure you have a mount that offers lava protection. Without lava protection, you won't be able to safely cross rivers of hot mozzarella. My recommendation would be to purchase vehicle deeds for either the Basilisk War Droid or Mustafarian Panning Droid, as they have higher speeds by default and offer lava protection. You could also claim and use the Lava Flea or Desert Skiff mounts via the reward claim window if you want to save some credits. The main quest to complete on Mustafar is called Fate of the Galaxy, which tasks players with preventing a malevolent force from spreading throughout the stars. Even better than triumphing over evil are the rewards you'll get to choose between at the end: the Layer Crystal or the Shard of Retaliation buff items. Both of these items are frequently used by players, as the Layer Crystal primarily boosts a player's offensive abilities, while the Shard focuses on increasing defensive attributes for a short period of time. Before you can take on this important task, you'll have to prove your abilities by completing other quests across Mustafar first. 11 specific quests must be completed before your character qualifies for Fate of the Galaxy. Completing all of these quests alone is possible, but may prove difficult in some instances, like when you're faced with a boss NPC. So, you may need to find another player to help you out. Let's set our blasters to constant fire and get through this list. Beginning in the Men 6 mining facility where you land, you'll want to aid a historian with his research on Jedi ruins and the Old Republic, conduct field research for a Xeno-archaeologist, who will reward you for your efforts with the previously mentioned Chugon Dar Cube, retrieve an item of interest for this droid's master, exact revenge on a thief who believes they can get away with stealing from Ikt, cure a man of his bad luck streak, choose to break or support a miner's union strike, and negotiate with an aloof Ithorian. Outside of the mining facility, you'll want to look into preventing a plague from spreading across the galaxy, gathering and reassembling the shards of a lost artifact, rescuing the Bothans Jor'al and Tarpur from the influence of an evil cult, which will reward you with a Mustafarian Injector, a buff item you'll want to add to your collection, and finally looting an old vault of lost technology. A few minutes after completing the 11th quest, you'll be visited by the Ethereal Spirit, who will ask you to fulfill your destiny. If the spirit doesn't appear or spawns in a location that prevents you from conversing with it, you can summon it using this holocron, located on the shore of Remorse, outside the active Men 6 mining facility. The Ethereal Spirit can only be summoned by players who qualify for the Fate of the Galaxy quest and haven't completed it yet. While on Mustafar, you may want to consider starting the Champion of Mustafar quest series by speaking with Foreman Shivos in the mining facility. The quests part of the series don't reward the player with anything spectacular, but serve as a prerequisite for accessing some of the unique group-oriented instances on the planet. These instances are older content that typically rewards players with outdated or completely worthless items. However, some of the items are still highly valued in the current state of the game, like the Sprint Enhancement Stim, which gives players a massive boost to their movement speed for a short period of time. Current player gear also outpaces this older content, which makes it possible to complete with less than 4 players, or even alone in some cases. Either way, I recommend completing the prerequisite quests up until you're tasked with the first group objective, creating an uplink by clearing the Kubaza Beetle Cavern. That way, if you find other players willing to help you get access to the Mustafar instances, you'll be able to jump into the first instance immediately. Getting back to the Force-sensitive population, all Jedi should speak with Montanero in the city of Tyrena on Corellia. This will activate the Master Jedi Cloaks Collection, a series of collections that will reward the player with 5th generation lightsaber schematics, new abilities, and gear they'll want for optimizing their character's combat build. These collections require Jedi to collect many rare artifacts, defeat deadly foes, and complete trials around the galaxy. Have patience and persevere, as obtaining your Master Jedi Cloaks will take a few hours at the minimum, and possibly tens of millions of credits if you want to bypass some of the luck involved with the process. Not specific to Jedi, but of great interest, is the Witches of Dathomir theme park. The reason being is that this quest series is arguably the easiest way of obtaining lightsaber color crystals that provide a 6% elemental damage boost to your lightsaber, the current highest elemental damage bonus available in the game. You can begin the theme park by conversing with Amog's representative at the Dathomir Trade Outpost. These quests will eventually lead you to meeting Rubina, an NPC who will help you gain favor and entry to one of the following two groups, the Singing Mountain Clan or Night Sister Witches. If you don't have a compelling personal or roleplay reason for aligning with either clan, know that the Singing Mountain Clan's lightsaber crystal provides an acid elemental damage to your weapon, while the Night Sisters provides heat. If you decide you want both color crystals, you can return to Rubina in the future, repeat the quest she has for the clan you didn't earn favor with the first time, and then purchase the color crystal from them. Bounty hunters will want to consider starting, and possibly completing, the Dangerous Fugitives Collection. This collection will have you checking the bounty on humanoid NPC targets in the hopes of revealing a high-value target to defeat in combat. Completing this collection will reward the player with schematics for the master-crafted EE-3 carbine and the DC-15 rifle. Smugglers will want to travel to Bastine and speak with Barak to begin underworld smuggling missions. Completing these missions will earn the smuggler reputation in the underworld. This is important, as gaining Underworld Smuggler ranks gives the smuggler passive increases to their damage, attack range, and armor. Missions later in the series will also reward players with illegal weapon modules, which are required to use the Modify Weapon ability. Modify Weapon consumes one illegal module in the smuggler's inventory in exchange for a buff that increases their damage up to 12% for 30 minutes. Given all of these perks, it is hard to overlook becoming a Master Underworld Smuggler. I've linked to a Master Underworld Smuggler guide in the description of this video. The Irelia Township on Dathomir serves as a hub for high-level players seeking to participate in endgame content. This includes hosting multiple prerequisite quests players must complete if they want to gain access to the game's five main dungeons, known as heroics. Heroics are important because they contain enemies required for completing the Master Jedi Cloaks collection and reward players with one token each time a heroic encounter is completed. These tokens are then used to purchase items from the trinket shop in Irelia, with the most desired items being jewelry pieces that improve a character's stats or grant them new abilities. You want to collect all five pieces of a jewelry set to receive its full benefits. Before we begin visiting quest NPCs, let's make our life much easier by speaking with Maximilian. Talking with the travel consultant will allow us to quickly travel back to Irelia by speaking with Irelia contacts placed in certain locations throughout the galaxy. Once you've completed the prerequisite quests, Maximilian will offer transportation to most heroic encounters, which will save you a few long drives. Max can also take you to select starports around the galaxy, but this service isn't as attractive since the starship terminal is located in the structure nearby. Now that we've familiarized ourselves with the local travel system, let's accept the main quests we're here for. There are five quests you will want to collect before leaving Irelia. You can find the first one by entering the guild hall and following the right wall until you see Nim's envoy. Converse with the Jory to accept the Nim Slicer quest. Go back to the main room, walk past the cold weather rebel trooper, and converse with the Corellia University teaching assistant to begin the Controlling Spirit quest. At the opposite end of this back room is someone cosplaying as a Tusken Raider. Speak with the Tusken fanatic to initiate the Tusken Scholar quest. Next, exit the back room, go past the Imperial Snowtrooper, and stay to the right. Click on the Night Sister headdress on display to accept the fourth quest. To receive the fifth and final prerequisite quest, the Lost Star Destroyer, you'll need to speak to one of three NPCs in or around the Guild Hall. The NPC you need to speak with is determined by your current affiliation in the ongoing Galactic Civil War. Imperials will want to return to the back room at the rear of the guild hall so they can receive instructions from Major Appleton. Unaligned players will want to speak with Hyrel Chindier, who is standing next to Major Appleton. Rebel characters will need to exit the guild hall to find Lieutenant Thulo, posted on the north side of the building's exterior. Instead of immediately setting off to complete the quest you just accepted, I recommend visiting the town's elder, Rohak. After a brief discussion, he'll offer you a quest to collect six small figures spread throughout the town of Irelia. Doing so will reward the player with a unique item called the Box of Achievements. This item allows the player to store a variety of tokens, accommodations, and currencies that would normally be kept in your inventory as separate items. Some of these currencies can even be removed from the box later for display or trading with other players. If you're having a hard time finding the figures, here's a list of waypoints that will guide you to each one. While the original Avatar platform instance won't interest most players, the hard mode version created by the SWG Legends developers offers a new challenge and unique loot to those skilled enough to take on tougher enemies. In order to access this new content, you'll first have to complete two missions for the original Avatar platform instance. First, you'll want to make sure that you have a few piloting levels and an appropriate ship. If piloting isn't your thing, then you'll at least want to have a starter ship and ask another pilot for an escort. Second, you'll need access to the Edie hunting grounds on Kashyyyk. If you haven't already, speak with Kursok east of Kachiro and complete his quests until he instructs you to speak with Sordan Riss. Once you've made it this far, you'll be able to access the Edie hunting grounds. Note that gaining access to the Edie hunting grounds will require you to complete one space quest, so have that pilot friend handy if you haven't advanced your own piloting skills already. Now that you're prepared for space missions and have access to Edie, travel to the West Slaver Camp in Kachiro and speak with Boshaz, a member of the Tradition Clan Zisik, who will either be on top of or under this structure depending on how social he's feeling. Once you complete the space escort mission he assigns you, Boshaz will tell you to find a Wookiee named Charu. Before setting out, you may want to ask another level 90 player to lend you a hand with the upcoming quests, as there will be combat encounters that some level 90 characters will find challenging alone. Eventually, you'll meet the Zisik clan leader, Hissisik Bloodscale, who will give you the Assault on Avatar questline, which involves flying to the Avatar platform, collecting guard ID cards there, defeating a Wookiee named Harakakok the Mighty, and activating Avatar Platform's self-destruct sequence. Once you've completed these tasks and claimed your reward from Hissisic, speak to the clan leader again to pick up the repeatable quest, Assault on Avatar Hard Mode. While you can pick up the hard mode version of this quest now, you won't be able to enter the hard mode instance until you impress one more NPC. Travel back to the Kachiro starport and speak with Miriam Valmont near the base of the Kachiro tree. Miriam will hire you to fly back to the Avatar platform and collect 5 substances scattered across the instance. This mission only requires that you collect these 5 substances, so you don't have to destroy the station again. Once you've obtained all the items, eject back to Kachiro and return to Miriam to receive your modest reward. If you speak with her again, you should see an option to select hard mode. Do not select this option unless you're with a group and ready to tackle hard mode, as Miriam will instantly teleport you to the instance once you select the option. The Jedi Theme Park Prologue is content unique to SWG Legends, which offers 2 original heroics similar to the Aurelia heroics, boasting greater challenges and unique rewards. Similar to the high-level content covered in the previous sections of this video, these instances also have prerequisite quests players will need to complete before they can enter them. Unlike previous prerequisite quests, you will need a group of at least 4 level 90 players who are geared beyond the entry recommendations made in this video, or a full group of 8, to complete these quests. Regardless of group size, you want at least 1 medic to accompany you. Bringing a defensive character, like a frontman commando or light side Jedi, and an officer with the General's Aspect jewelry set is recommended for small groups, but not essential for groups with 8 players. I want to note that it is possible for Jedis with Combat Force Cloak and Spies to complete these prerequisite quests alone. However, I don't recommend attempting this, as the enemies in this quest line can deathblow, so one mistake will cost you time you otherwise would not have wasted with a group. Once the team is assembled, travel to the Light Jedi Temple on Yavin 4. Jedis will want to seek out Master Koa for guidance, while non-Force sensitives speak with Kama Vol. These NPCs will ask you to investigate small sites around the east side of the planet, which will lead you to discover a Dark Jedi Temple. This is where you and your group will face a new evil dwelling deep under the mountain, in hopes of staving off another threat to the galaxy. Once you've gained entry to the first of 2 instances, you'll want to find a group of well-equipped players to take on the remaining challenges inside. I hope you found this quick rundown helpful for getting your level 90 combat profession started on SWG Legends. If you feel there's something I missed, have your own tips to share, or have any questions, please leave a comment on this video. If you found this video helpful and would like to see more videos from me like this one, please consider liking the video, as that's useful feedback for me. Subscribing to this channel will also let me know that people are looking forward to more content like this. Thanks for watching this far. If you want to chat with me or see more Star Wars Galaxies gameplay, I currently stream it multiple times a week on twitch.tv.
Does he do less damage if I suck him? I'm at
Hey Griffin, can you clip that for me? I'm a little busy right now. Can you clip that for me, please?
God damn
it. We have fun there. A link to the Twitch channel is in the description if you want to follow me over there. Until next time, stay hungry.